Our gospel reading this morning is from the Gospel of Luke, starting in the 15th chapter with the first verse. Now, this story is familiar to you. You probably have it memorized. So I'd invite you this morning to make a little extra effort to hear what God is speaking to you and maybe discover or notice something that you have never noticed about this story before. So let's listen for the word of God. All the tax collectors and people were gathering around Jesus to listen to him. The Pharisees and legal experts were grumbling, saying, "This man welcomes sinners and eats with them." Jesus told them this parable. A certain man had two sons. The younger son said to his father, "Father, give me my share of the inheritance." And so the father divided his estate between them. Soon afterward, the younger son gathered everything together and took a trip to a land far away. There he wasted his wealth through extravagant living. When he had used up his resources, a severe food shortage arose in that country, and he began to be in need. He hired himself out to one of the citizens of that country, who sent him into his field to feed pigs. He longed to eat his fill from what the pigs ate, but no one gave him anything. And so when he came to his senses, he said, "How many of my father's hired hands have more than enough? But I am starving. I will get up and go to my father and say, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I no longer deserve to be called your son. Take me on as one of your hired hands.'" So he got up and he went to his father. While he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was moved with compassion. His father ran to him and hugged him and kissed him. And his son said, "Father, I've sinned against heaven and against you. I no longer deserve to be called your son." But the father said to his servants, "Quick, bring out the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Fetch the fatted calf and slaughter it. We must celebrate with feasting, because a son of mine was dead and has come back to life. He was lost and is found." They began to celebrate. Now his older son was in the field, and coming in from the field, he approached the house and heard music and dancing. He called one of the servants and asked them what was going on. The servant replied, "Your brother is here. Your father has slaughtered the fatted calf because he received his son back safe and sound." And then the older son was furious and didn't want to enter. But his father came out and begged him. The older son answered his father, "Look, I've served you all these years, and I never disobeyed your instructions. Yet you've never given me as much as a young goat so I could celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours returned after gobbling up your estate, you slaughtered the fatted calf for him." And then his father said, "Son, you are always with me, and everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate and be glad, because this brother of yours was dead and is alive. He was lost and is found." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. I told Jeremy last week, I'm always afraid when I stand up and start talking that I won't have anything to say. That I'll get up and I'll have used everything that there is to say about God up the week before. That is not the problem this morning. Problem this morning is I have too much to say. I have too much to say because this parable has always bothered me. It has always bothered me my entire life. I never understood why people loved this parable so much. It has always rubbed me the wrong way. I've never liked it. But that's what parables are supposed to do. If you find a parable comforting, you're reading it wrong. Jesus tells parables to bother you. They're supposed to get under your skin. They're supposed to cause a little bit of an itch there. You're supposed to hear a parable and go, "Huh?" Parables are supposed to bother us. They should not feel comfortable. They should not feel familiar. They should feel like something that causes us to question what we came to the parable with. And so we come this morning to a parable that all of us have heard probably every 3 years our entire life. When the Harvest team was meeting to talk about the scriptures this year, somebody said, "Good luck with that one. I think I've heard everything there is to say about that parable by now." And I said, yes, you're probably right. But the truth is that I think the reason this parable bothers me is because I've never read it correctly. I've heard story after story after story about this parable. I've heard sermon after sermon after sermon on this parable. I've gone to VBSs. I've done Sunday schools. I was in a couple plays that involved this parable. I know it inside out, but I think I've always missed it. Because when you go back to the foundations, when you go back to the purpose of the Bible, when you go back to the reason that people have found this book to be so special and important, it is because this story is not about us. I'm going to guess that most of the sermons you've heard about this parable have been something along the lines of, if you are a younger son, then it's great, you got to be welcomed home. Or maybe you're the older son and you're mad and angry because other people get let in. And I'm going to guess that every sermon that you've heard, like mine, has been focused on the children. But the Bible is not about you. It's not about you. The Bible is wholly unconcerned about you as an individual in this time and in this place. The Bible is worried about who God is and how God shows up. The Bible is a collection of stories about God, the history of God, the person of God, the way God has shown up from beginning to end, the hopes and desires God has for us. The stories are not about us. They are about God. And so when we look at this parable again, when we remember that this parable is one of three parables told in a row as one big story, when we remember that Jesus was responding to a question about the nature of God, maybe that opens up this story for us a little bit. The first story in this parallel trio is the story of the lost sheep. You know this one. There are 99 sheep in the field, and the shepherd notices that one is lost. And so the shepherd goes and finds the lost sheep and brings him back to the fold. The second parable is about a lost coin. There's a hole in somebody's bag, and they drop one coin out of their bag. And so the person goes and searches for days and days until they find that one lost coin. The story is about how God seeks, how God offers grace, about God's actions. And so this parable is not about the younger son, and it's not about the older son. It is about the Father. It's about the Father. It's about what the Father does in this story. The Father who offers grace at the beginning of the story, not at the end. I don't know about you, but if I went to my parents and said, hey, Mom and Dad, will you give me all your money? Their response would not be graceful. In fact, they keep threatening with all of their stuff. Every once in a while, they'll come by and I'll go by and they'll say, one day all of this will be yours. And I say, no, thank you. The story is not about the sins of the younger son or the fact that the younger son decides to go off and adventure for a little while. The story is about the Father giving him the freedom to do that. The Father being gracious enough to say, if that's what you need, then go. I think being a younger son is hard. I think being a younger son is hard. I think being an older son is hard. In fact, I think the hardest configuration of any family whatsoever is two sons. It's hard. There's a lot of expectations from our culture on how older sons and younger sons are supposed to react to things. The Bible sets us up in the same way. The older son is always responsible and does what they're supposed to do. Every Bible story about older sons and younger sons involves people like Esau doing exactly what they were supposed to do. The younger sons are always getting in trouble. The younger sons who do not have the pressure of maintaining the family line. The younger sons who do not have the pressure of doing whatever their father did. You see, for 2,000 years, you did what your dad did. If you were the oldest son, you did what your dad did. If your dad was a farmer, you were a farmer. If your dad made tires, you made tires. In fact, most of our family names come from the fact that your great-great-great-great-grandfather did what their great-great-great-great-grandfather did. Oldest sons are told that they need to follow in the family line. They need to hold up the lineage of the family. They have all this pressure. My brother, for a long time, had two female girl children. And I talked to him for a little while, and he said, "You know, I'm the last of the line, right? I'm the last Glasser that there is. My cousins didn't have children." And he felt so much pressure to have a child who could carry on the family name. So much pressure for older children. The younger children, on the other hand, have this question of what they're supposed to do because they don't get to inherit the identity. The family business goes to the older son. What does the younger son have to do? In fact, if you've spent any time watching TV lately, you'll notice that there's a very public fight between an older son and a younger son, one of them who lives in California now. Because he grew up his entire life being called the spare. Prince Harry wrote a whole book about how his brother William always knew what his life was supposed to be about. He was going to be king. He was trained to be king from the moment he was born. Harry was always an extra. And so he had the burden of discovering an identity, of figuring out a purpose for his life, of discovering who he would be, because his only purpose in life was to be there in case his brother died. So much pressure. And the grace that the father offers in this parable is the grace of allowing those two sons to escape from that pressure. When the younger son came to his dad with a plan to go off and discover who he was, I think the father felt relief. I think the father extended that grace because he knew that as long as he lived in his house, he was always going to be second. The father extends grace when the younger son returns home because he realizes that his identity was always at home. That whatever it looked like, he always had a place he could go to. He always had a father who loved him. He always had that hand of extended grace. When he was hungry, he knew that he could go home. But the father is not ending there with grace. The grace of that father extends to the oldest son, who is rightly angry. Rightly angry because he feels abandoned. He feels like all the pressure is now on him. Before, he had a partner, but he left. And so when the older son comes dirty and gross and tired from working in the fields and they're having a party without him, he's understandably angry. But the father extends grace to the son and says, "I know. I know this has been hard. I see that your life has been hard. I recognize where you are and the pressure that is on your life. I see that. But this is a moment to celebrate because we are whole as a family again. We make the mistake of trying to make this faith thing about us. Faith is not about you and your individual choices or the mistakes that you make. It's not about those things. We have inherited a legacy, a religious legacy that focuses on the sin of the individual. But there's nowhere in the gospel story where Jesus is at all concerned about the sins of the individual. Jesus doesn't ever ask anybody what kind of sins they've committed that day to deserve whatever happened to them. When people come to Jesus for healing, Jesus says, "Thank you, I'm so glad that you're here." Jesus never once says to them, "Hey, did you get lame because you did something stupid?" I looked it up the other day. Sin is mentioned twice in the gospel. Four books of the gospels, the word sin appears twice. They're both in Matthew. And both of them are concerned about the things we do to each other, the way that we treat each other. Never once does Jesus talk about sin. Jesus is not concerned about that. What Jesus is concerned about is the fact that you know that you have the grace and the freedom to be who you are in God. To be who you are, to live into the identity God gave you, to be free from the pressures of the world that tell you you have to be a certain way or act a certain way, that you have to live up to some sort of impossible standard of being good enough. Jesus is not concerned about that. Jesus does not care if you messed up last night. Jesus does not care if you sinned last night. Jesus is concerned about whether you are willing to seek the wholeness that comes with grace. To remember that you are not in this alone, that your individual acts are not the most important thing about this world, that faith is a gift that is given to you by God, and there's nothing you can do to lose it, nothing you can do to earn it. Because Jesus does not care about your individual action, except for when it keeps you from full relationship with God. We will never find a path to God if we're so focused on ourselves. The people in the gospel who are healed by Jesus do it because they are thinking about God first. They do it, they are healed and brought wholeness because their focus is entirely upon Jesus, not on themselves. You never once hear them talk about themselves. The woman who had been bleeding for 2 weeks does everything she can to get close to Jesus, and Jesus just heals her. He never says, "What have you done to earn it today, lady?" When the friends bring their friend to Jesus and lower him through the roof, Jesus says, "Thank goodness you're here. I'm so glad to see you." Our individual hang-ups, our individual brokenness, never ever keeps us back unless we let it. God's grace is in the freedom to be defined by something else. To be defined first by how God sees you. To be defined first how other people see you. To be defined first not by the worst parts of yourself, but by the best parts of yourself. Every time that you live into the gifts God has given you, every time that you try to be a better version of who you are, every time you try to be a more whole version of who you are, Jesus celebrates and rejoices and is excited. And so maybe we can accept that challenge from Jesus and say that we too can go home. That we too can maybe take a deep breath and relax a little bit. That we too can maybe just celebrate that we have found God and worry a little bit less about the things that we're not so good at. Maybe we can risk trying something that's really hard again. Maybe we can risk being a better version of ourselves. Maybe we can risk not judging ourselves so much. Maybe we could accept that we will never exceed expectations. You are enough the way you are. The only thing God wants for you is to come home. And to hear the words that God has for you, which is this: "I'm so glad you're here. I am so glad you are here." Amen.